Students, good morning. Students, in the last class we have discussed about object-oriented programming principles. So you know what is an object-oriented programming, what is the necessity of writing a program using the principles of object-oriented programming, and what are all the object-oriented programming principles and how it plays a vital role in developing the real-time application. That is what we have discussed in the last class. And you know, there are 7 object-oriented programming principles we have discussed in the last class. We have also discussed in detail about all the 7 principles. So before starting today's class, let us have a recap for all those 7 object-oriented programming principles. In order to have this recap, I am planning for an activity which is nothing but a pick and extend activity. So using this activity, if you all are having some recap, you will not forget the concepts forever, because these concepts are very, very helpful for your placements as well as your career. So in order to have that thing, I have an idea of executing an activity which is called pick and extend activity. So what does we will do here in the sense, I will call your numbers in random. So the student who I am calling, you have to tell me about brief about that particular topic for some 2 or 3 minutes, so that other will have the recap of that topic. That is what my idea. Students, are you ready? Students, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So let us move further. So totally 7 object-oriented programming principles we have discussed yesterday. So you are going to give the recap. These are the flashcards for the 7 principles. I have given the flashcards. Now, in your register number, from your students group, let me call some of you in random. So what you should do means you have to pick up any one of the cards, and the topic will be displayed for that card. So you have to extend that topic by briefing that one. Okay. So first, let me call the register number 70. So who is register number 70?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Number 5.
Number 5. Okay. So the topic you are going to brief about is nothing but objects. You can continue.
Good morning, friends. I'm going to explain about objects in Java. Objects. It is defined as a basic runtime entity. Objects are considered as the instance of the class. Objects are mainly composed of 2 types. They are data variables and methods. In simple terms, we can say that objects is equal to data plus methods. Data. It is a representation of properties or characteristics of an object. And methods, it is a representation of the behavior or action of the objects. Objects will occupy some memory space, and hence it will have some allocated memory address. For example, if we consider an object as a dog has color, breed, and age, which are its attributes, whereas barking, sleeping, are its behavior. Objects are created using 4 ways: using new keyword, using clone method, using string class name method, and deserialization. Mostly objects are created using new keyword. Other ways are internally use new methods to create the object. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Patrick Raja. So students, I think you got the recap over this objects. So first of all, objects is a runtime or real world entity. So it is considered as an instance for the class. Right, that is what we have discussed yesterday. It is considered as an instance for the class. And 2 points regarding objects, you want to remember, for your entire career, objects will occupy memory space. It will have its own associated address. Okay, and the remaining things have been briefed by Karthik Raja. So I hope everyone is clear with the objects. Okay, so let us move for the next one. So now let me call upon register number 77. Please, register number 77.
Myself, ma'am, Kishan.
Okay, Kishan, you can pick up your flashcard.
Number 3, ma'am.
Number 3. Okay. your topic is message passing. You can read about this message passing.
Good morning, everyone. I am here to explain about message passing. Message passing, in terms of object-oriented programming, we can say that sending an object from one process to another process, that is, sending objects from one thread to another thread. This communication can be feasible once the process is alive. The best example for message passing is producer-consumer example. The message passing, we have to do three steps, that is, creating classes, creating objects, and extending communication between two processes. In this process, when there are two threads that do not share memory, an object is sent using message passing. Thank you.
Thank you, Kishan. So students, you got the recap over message passing. As Kishan said, the main part of the message passing is communication. See students, we have created a class, we have created an object. Is it enough? Means the answer is no. There should be a communication. We have to establish a communication between the objects in order to share the information, in order to share the data variables, then only our application will get success. Okay, so for that, the principle what we are using is nothing but message passing. Okay, so let us move for the next one. So already the chords 5 and 3 have been selected by our friends. So let me call upon some other register number 54. Who is register number 54?
Ma'am?
Yes.
I choose number 6.
Okay, fine. Number 6. So your topic is classes.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about the topic classes in Java. A class is a user-defined prototype from which objects are created. In Java programming language, a class is a basically user-defined data type that acts as a template for creating objects of the identical type. It represents the common properties and actions of an object. In other words, classes can also be defined as a class is a group of objects which are common to all objects of one type. Declarations of class in Java. A class can be declared using the keyword class followed by a class name. It also a body within the braces. The general syntax to declare a class in Java is, I'm going to say, syntax modifier name, class, class name, open braces, class body, close braces. Components of class in Java. In general, a class can have the following components to act as a template: modifiers, class name, and body. So I'm going to give the basic difference between class and object in Java. There are the following differences. A class is a user-defined data type, whereas an object is an instance of a class data type. A class generates objects, whereas an object gives life to a class. Class do not occupy memory location, but objects occupy memory location. Classes cannot be manipulated due to not available in the memory location, but objects can be manipulated. A class is also considered as a user-defined data type because a user creates a class. That's it, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Thank you, Sadiq. Classes, the details of classes have been provided by Sadiq. So the main thing is class is like a template. So it will have its structure, template. It is a user-defined data type. And you have to remember, it doesn't occupy any memory space. So it does not have any associated address in the memory. Once, if you instantiate the class, the objects will be created, which are called the instances of the classes, and the objects will occupy memory space. So you should remember the differences between the classes and objects. And when you say about the classes, you know the advantages of the classes, why are we going for classes, and Sadiq also has explained how to define a class in Java, what is the syntax, everything has been explained by Sadiq. Okay, shall we move for the next one? So already the number 3, 5, 6, the chords have been picked up. So next, let me call the register number 65. Is 65?
Yes, ma'am. Myself, Kanimuri.
Kanimuri. Okay, Kanimuri, can you pick up your number?
Number 1, ma'am.
Number 1. Okay. So your topic is encapsulation and data abstraction.
Encapsulation. Encapsulation is defined as the wrapping up of data under a single unit. It is a mechanism that binds together code and the data it manipulates. As an encapsulation, the data in a class is hidden from the other classes. It is also called as data hiding or information hiding. Encapsulation can be achieved by declaring all the variables in a class as private. Data abstraction. Data abstraction DAB is actually using access specifiers. In Java, there are four access specifiers, namely default, private, public, and protected. The default access specifier is accessible only within the package. The public access specifier is accessible everywhere. The private access specifier is accessible only within the class. The protected access specifier is accessible within the package and outside the package through the child class. The practical example of data abstraction is as follows. When a user is given a switchboard, he doesn't need to know the circuitry connections of the switchboard. Instead, he can just know the on or off operations. The same can be applied to the programming concept also. Thank you.
Thank you, Kavindri, for your real-time example. So students, I think you got the recap of the encapsulation and data abstraction. As I said yesterday, I explained it yesterday. Encapsulation is nothing but wrapping up of data and its associated methods within a single unit. So thereby, we are providing security. We are providing data hiding, information hiding, so that your security plays a vital role there. And what is the name of the unit means? The name of the unit is nothing but class. So the mechanism is encapsulation, whereas the entire unit is nothing but a class. So we are covering the data and its associated functions into a single unit, which is nothing but a class, and the name we are giving for this mechanism is encapsulation. And with the help of the access specifiers, like as Kanimani said, four access specifiers have been supported in Java: default, public, private, protected. So because with the help of these access specifiers, data abstraction, what is necessary, that alone we are projecting to the user. Unnecessary background details, how the implementation is done, the credentials of your applications will not be revealed to the user. That is data abstraction. Okay, fine. Let us go for the next one. So already records 1, 3, 5, 6 have been picked up. So next, let me call some other register number 75.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Number 7, ma'am.
Okay, 75 is picking up the code 7, and your topic is polymorphism.
Good afternoon, everyone. My topic is polymorphism. The derivation of the word polymorphism is from two different Greek words, poly and morphism. Poly means numerous, and morphism means forms. So polymorphism means innumerable forms. Polymorphism is one of the most significant features of object-oriented programming. Polymorphism in Java can be defined as a task that can perform a single action in different ways. In real-time example, an individual can have different relationship with different people. A woman can be a mother, a daughter, a sister, a friend, and all at the same time. And another example is, in human body has different organs. Every organ has different function to perform. So we have a standard method function that performs differently depending upon the organ of the body. The polymorphism Java can be performed by two methods, method overloading and method overriding. And it has two classification. One is static or compile time polymorphism and dynamic or runtime polymorphism. Some advantages: it provides reusability to the code. The classes that are written, tested, and implemented can be reused multiple times. Also, the code can be changed without affecting the original code. Some disadvantages: polymorphism is quite challenging while implementation. It tends to reduce the readability of the code. It raises some serious performance issues in real time. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiran. So polymorphism, good real-time examples. The way of explaining is very good. So poly is many. Morph is nothing but the different actions or behavior. So one external interface that is used to perform different internal actions. So in terms of programming, one external interface but different internal behavior. That is called polymorphism. As Kiran said, we are having two types of polymorphism. One is compile-time polymorphism, another one is runtime polymorphism. The example for compile-time polymorphism: operation overloading, function overloading, which is called method overloading. That is coming for runtime polymorphism, it is method overriding. Overloading is different from overriding. So we will shortly see what is overriding and role. We will shortly see. So runtime polymorphism, method overriding, or we can say dynamic method dispatch, all those things comes under runtime polymorphism. As she said, we are having both advantages and disadvantages in polymorphism. Okay, now let us move for the next one. So already the cards 1, 3, 5, 6, 7 have been picked up. The left out cards are 2 and 4. So let me call the register number 82. Who is 82?
Yes, ma'am. Myself, Lahari Sai, ma'am.
Good. Lahari Sai.
Yes, ma'am. I'm picking number 2, ma'am.
Number 2. Good. So your topic is inheritance.
Yes. Warm greetings, friends. I've selected the topic inheritance. Inheritance in object-oriented programming. Inheritance is a mechanism in which one class acquires the property of another class. That is, we can create a general class that defines traits common to a set related items. This class may then be inherited by other, more specific classes, each adding only those things that are unique to the inheriting class. The concept of inheritance allows the reusability of the code. We have two main classes in inheritance. They are superclass or parent class, and the other one is subclass or the child class. The class which gets inherited is called the superclass. The code of this class is passed onto a subclass where it is reused. In subclass, it is the derived class which inherits the superclass and it uses its member functions. Let us know the types of inheritance. There are different types of inheritance in object-oriented programming. They are single inheritance, multi-level inheritance, multiple inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. In single inheritance, there is only one superclass and one subclass. For example, if we consider class A and B, class B is inherited by class A. In multi-level inheritance, a derived class is inherited by another class, thus making multiple levels. For example, class B is inherited by A and class C is inherited by B. Multi-level inheritance. A class can inherit the attributes of two or more classes. This is known as multiple inheritance. For example, class C is inherited by both class A and B. Hierarchical inheritance. When a base class is inherited by multiple derived classes, it is called hierarchical inheritance. For example, class B and C are inherited by A. Hybrid inheritance. This is a mixture of two or more inheritances in a single code. Now let us know about inheritance in Java. Java inheritance is a mechanism in which one class acquires the property of another class. In Java, when an is-a relationship exists between two classes, we use inheritance. The parent class is a superclass and the inherited class is the subclass. The keyword extends is used by the subclass to inherit the features of the superclass. The general syntax of inheritance in Java is class, subclass, extends, superclass, and the statements and methods are mentioned within the curly braces. Now let us look at the advantages. We can save time because much of the code needed for our class is already written. We can extend and revise the parent class without corrupting the existing parent class features. Some of the disadvantages are removing or swapping out a superclass will usually break the subclass. It is inflexible. An inheritance relationship generally can't be altered at runtime. Thank you.
Thank you. So you have briefed about inheritance. The process of deriving one new class from the already existing class is nothing but inheritance. And the existing class is called superclass or the parent class. In terms of C++, it is called base class. In terms of Java, it is superclass. And the new class is called subclass or child class. In terms of C++, it is called derived class. Coming from Java, it is called subclass. And all other things, your friend has explained well. So in Java, one point I want to stress you. In Java, multiple inheritance is not supported. by the form, it is supporting the concept of multiple inheritance in some other form, which is nothing but interfaces. So through interfaces, we are supporting multiple inheritance in Java. As an inheritance part, it is not supported. Okay. So the reason why it is not supported, everything we will be discussing while discussing the topic of interfaces. And the main advantage of inheritance is code reusability. So reusability, so it eliminates redundancy. All these things are main advantages of inheritance. Okay. So let us move for the next one. So the next person, let me call upon the register number 53. So only one code is available. Register number 53.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. I'm going to choose 4, ma'am.
Yes, no other option. Okay, let me go for this 4. And your topic is dynamic binding.
Dynamic binding is an object-oriented programming concept and is related with polymorphism and inheritance. Dynamic binding definition is a dynamic binding means that a block of code execution with reference to a procedure call is determined at runtime. Dynamic dispatch is generally used when multiple classes contain different implementations of the same method. We also call dynamic binding as late binding because binding takes place during the actual execution of the program. The best example of dynamic binding is the method overriding, where both parent class and the derived classes have the same method. Coming to the advantages and disadvantages of dynamic binding, one of the major advantage of dynamic binding is flexibility. Due to the flexibility, a single function can handle different types of objects at runtime. In static binding, all information needed before the compilation time, while in dynamic binding, no information remains available before runtime. Coming to the disadvantage of dynamic binding, adds to the cost of implementation and type error detection by the compiler is difficult. This is about dynamic binding. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramrata. So dynamic binding, the actual linking of procedure with that of procedure call statement. You know, students, because of modular programming, we will be write the methods, functions, procedures. In our actual source program, we will call those procedures. So the procedure call with that of the actual definition of the procedure, this linking, then it is going to take place either at the static time or at the runtime. Static in the sense compile time or at the runtime. If it takes place at the compile time, then it is called static binding or early binding. Then it takes place at the runtime, at the time of execution, then it is called dynamic binding or late binding. And the dynamic binding, it is having its own advantages. Yesterday itself, I have briefed about all the advantages of dynamic binding, and object-oriented programming supports this dynamic binding to a greater extent, right? Okay, so we have completed the recap of all the 7 principles of object-oriented programming. So thank you, students, for providing the concepts, the quick recap of all the 7 principles. Now, as I said yesterday, so I have said to Kishan to summarize all the topics, all the 7 principles. I said Kishan to summarize all the 7 principles. So let me call upon Kishan to summarize all the 7 principles of object-oriented principles. Kishan, you can continue.
Can I share the PPT, ma'am?
Yes, Papi, share your PPT.
Is it visible, ma'am?
I think it's not visible. Students, anyone who please confirm, is it visible, Kishan's PPT?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay.
Now, I'm going to explain the object-oriented programming principles. First, Objects. Objects are real-time or runtime entity. It is made up of data and methods. It is the instance of classes. Classes are known as collection of objects. It consists of data and methods. Encapsulation and data abstraction. Wrapping of data into a single unit is called encapsulation, and accessing the data members without the background information is called data abstraction. Data abstraction is achieved using specifiers like public, protected, private, and default. Inheritance. Deriving a class from a superclass is called inheritance. It is an is-say relationship. Extends keyword is used in inheritance. The advantage is code reuse. The class which is derived from is called superclass, and the class which is deriving is called subclass. Polymorphism. The ability to take one form into another form is called polymorphism. There are two types, compile-time polymorphism and runtime polymorphism. Dynamic binding. The process of binding, process binding at the time of execution is called dynamic binding. It is known as static and dynamic binding. There are two types. Message passing. The communication between two threads is known as message passing in Java. Thank you.
Thank you, Kishan. Thanks for summarizing the object-oriented programming principles. Students, we had a good recap for the yesterday's topic. So with this, let us wind up this recap session and let us move for the today's session. Thank you, students. Thank you, everyone who have actively participated. And thanks for providing the recap. Thank you, students.